Today on Acoustic Tuesday, we're gonna talk budget. We're gonna talk guitars on a budget. I'm gonna feature five guitars that punch well above their price category. Yes, these guitars won't cost you any more than $300, and there's five of them that you need to know about. We're gonna dig into that list, that countdown, in just a moment, but first, I just wanna take one moment, and I want you to just listen up. Perk your ears up, call your fellow guitar geeks in the room, because I just wanna express some extreme gratitude for this community. This community that shows up every Tuesday and watches Acoustic Tuesday, of course on Tuesday. This community that places progress and fun above all else. This community that believes in connection with fellow guitar geeks. We find ourselves in a really lucky position in which I'm extremely grateful for, because regardless of extenuating circumstances, we can still connect on a weekly basis. We can still, from the comfort of our own home, wave our guitar geek flag and enjoy one another, and ultimately turn to the guitar in any time of worry, nervousness, stress, and anxiety. And I want to encourage you to do that, because the guitar has been a long-standing bright light in my life and has helped me through some very difficult times. In fact, a little bit later on today's show, I'm going to share one of those difficult times with you. It's a story that I've been wanting to tell for quite some time, but I feel like the time is finally right. So we'll dig into that story a bit later, but bottom line, I just want you to know that I appreciate you watching the show right now, whether you're catching it right when it airs or weeks afterwards. Thank you for watching the Acoustic Tuesday show, and thank you for being a guitar geek. I appreciate everyone here at Acoustic Life appreciates it, and by golly, your fellow guitar geeks appreciate it as well. Well, I guess I can call you acoustic guitar geeks. But with that being said, let's go ahead and dig into my five favorite bluegrass dreadnoughts that come in under $300. Yes, under $300. We're gonna do this in a countdown fashion, starting from five and going to one. So coming in at number five is one of my all-time favorites, the Yamaha FG-800. Yes, this used to be the FG-700S. Through some improvements in both bracing and topwood, we now have the FG-800, a powerful, budget-friendly dreadnought that comes in at a whopping $199 for a solid top bluegrass dreadnought that sounds incredible. It plays well and is extremely consistent. Back when I worked at Music Villa here in Bozeman, Montana, we sold, we would sell these things like hotcakes to beginner guitarists, people coming back to the guitar after a long time away, people that are veteran guitarists and just wanted a second guitar to maybe bring camping or something like that. This guitar is phenomenal, and I think you'll agree with me when you actually hear it being played. So without further ado, here's the Yamaha FG-800.
Jack's better.
Stellar guitar for just $200. And that brings me to the number four position. This guitar, I think you'll find extremely, well, a lot like the Yamaha FG-800, but subtly different, and I'll tell you why. It is the Fender CD60S. Yes, a product from Fender, and it has a solid top. It's extremely consistent, and when I was selling these some years ago, it actually came bundled with a hard shell case. And doing some research, it seems like the Fender CD60S is bundled with a lot of beginner kind of accessory packs, where you get the strap, the capo, the case, the tuner, etc., etc. But nonetheless, let's focus on the guitar itself. This guitar is extremely consistent. It does have a solid top, as I mentioned before, and it plays really smoothly. And the reason I added this guitar to the list in conjunction with the Yamaha FG-800 is because the Fender CD60S offers a little bit slimmer neck profile. For those of you who have smaller hands but still want a dreadnought size body, the Fender CD60S is a great fit. And yes, as I mentioned, or if I didn't mention, it comes in at a whopping $199 as well. A great budget-friendly dreadnought, and if you're wondering how it sounds, here is the Fender CD60S in all of its solid-topped glory. Stick.
Thank you.
added bonus, the Fender CD60S also comes in black. So you have a choice between natural and black. So if you wanna flex your style muscles and go for a little Johnny Cash vibe, you can go the black route. Or if you wanna stay natural, heck, you can go natural as well. I believe the price is exactly the same. Which brings me to the next guitar in our lineup. Coming in at number 3 is the Bristol BD16. There's an interesting thing about this guitar. It's about $249. I believe it comes with a gig bag, and I've also seen it bundled with some other beginner accessory packs, tuner, strap, you know the deal. But this guitar comes in at $249. But here's the interesting thing. It's all laminate. So you're saying to yourself, Tone, you just featured two guitars that were $200 with a solid top. Now you're gonna feature a guitar that's $250. That's all laminate? I don't get it. What gives? Well, let me tell you what gives. This guitar sounds incredible. And because it's all laminate, it's actually a little bit more durable in terms of humidification. It's not gonna move as much as a solid wood guitar would. In fact, if you're not a big fan of humidification, if you're looking for a camping guitar, if you're looking for a guitar that you can hang on the wall and not necessarily worry about all that much, this would be a great option. The Bristol BD16 is a very consistent guitar brought to you by the folks at Saga Musical Instruments. If that name doesn't ring a bell, those are the folks that make Blue Ridge guitars. Bristol sits right beneath Blue Ridge, and I think it captures that same vintage kind of dreadnought aesthetic. And I gotta say, it sounds darn good, but you don't have to just listen to me. Why don't you go ahead and listen to the guitar? Here's the Bristol BD16 brought to you by the fine folks at Elderly Instruments. Great looking dreadnought, and again, like I said, it really captures that vintage dreadnought vibe. So a great option if you're a festival guitar player, if you like going to festivals and picking in jam circles and things like that. That's one that could get a little rain on it, could get a little wind on it, could get a little bacon grease on it, could get a little beer on it, could get a little, well, I don't know, spit up on it if you bring a kid, and you wouldn't necessarily have to worry about it because it's only $250. All right, moving right along, coming in at the number 2 position, this is a guitar that I have some intimate experience with because I used to sell them, the Alvarez AD60S. This guitar has it all, in my opinion. It's got the aesthetics, it's got a solid top, it's got forward shifted scallop bracing, so it's very responsive. You'll see that it has binding around the top, it's got an abalone rosette, a beautiful looking guitar, and a great sounding guitar as well. I think it ticks all the boxes. It's got the aesthetics, it's got the sound, it's got the look, it's got everything. And I have to say, these guitars are incredibly consistent. When I was working in Chicago at the Old Town School of Folk Music, we brought on Alvarez guitars, and the AD60S was a continual top selling model for us because of all the reasons I listed. Now, you don't have to listen to me. You can listen to the guitar itself. If you're wondering about the price, it comes in at just under $300, $1 less than $300, yes, $299. And I believe, at least at the time I was selling them, they came with a hard case. That might not be true right now, so don't mark my words on that, but we're talking about the guitar here, so let's have a listen to the Alvarez AD60S. So here we find ourselves at the number 1 position, but wait! Before I go to the number 1 position, you're probably thinking, he's probably gonna make me wait till the end of the show to reveal the number 1 guitar. You know, that's how most network TV shows do it. No, not here on Acoustic Tuesday. We're gonna jump right into the number one position. And my number one bluegrass dreadnought, under $300, is the Takamine GD20NS. Why is this guitar in the number one position? It offers a different tone from all the other guitars I've listed thus far. Why? Because it has a solid, yes, I said that right, solid cedar top. A solid cedar top offering a much more warm, woody, delicate tone. For those of you that have a lighter touch, this is a great match because this guitar freely offers sound. It's got the volume, it's got the punch, it's got the richness, it's got the depth of tone. And yes, you're wondering, is it really under $300? It is. It is indeed. It's $1 less than $300. It comes in at $299. It has the Takamine signature split saddle, and it sounds just darn good. It sounds thick and just juicy with acoustic tone. So, if you're wondering what that sounds like, a thick, juicy acoustic tone, I'm wondering myself because I just used that descriptor for the first time. It felt kind of weird, so I'm gonna see if the guitar actually matches what I described. Here's the Takamine GD20NS. So it's true, I'm in agreement with myself of about 40 seconds ago when I said that the Takamine GD20NS is thick, juicy, and I'm gonna even add meaty to that description because the guitar sounds darn good for a $299 guitar. Now let's give a quick rundown of my top five bluegrass guitars under $300. Coming in at number five is the Yamaha FG-800. Coming in at number four, the Fender CD60S. Number three, the Bristol BD16. Number two, the Alvarez AD60S. And then the number one spot, the Takamine GD20NS. A great list of guitars, but I know this, there are a lot more guitars that are under $300. And if you're sitting there thinking, Tone, I can't believe you missed my favorite guitar. Don't worry, I didn't miss it. I might just not have experienced it yet. But if you want other guitar geeks to experience it, please leave in the comments below what your favorite bluegrass dreadnought under $300 is. Under $300 is. In fact, I would love to compile a great list for all of us guitar geeks to look at and experience because some guitars are on our radar while others are not. So let's make this episode an awesome list of budget-friendly bluegrass guitars. Go ahead and leave those comments below and I will feature those in an upcoming episode of Acoustic Tuesday. All right, this week on Acoustic Tuesday, you've already learned about five dreadnoughts that do not break the bank. You're gonna get the scoop on some mailbag arrivals that are out of the ordinary, both digital and otherwise. You'll see what I'm talking about. I'm gonna offer up an artist that might be on your radar, but if not, absolutely should be. And then lastly, I'm gonna tell you a story that, like I said before, I've been wanting to tell for a long time. It's a personal story, and it's one that I think, well, you guitar geeks are a perfect audience for, so I can't wait to share that with you. That's all coming up right after this. I'm Tony Policastro, and this is the Acoustic Tuesday Show. Guitar geeks, unite. Welcome to Acoustic Tuesday, episode 135. This is the show where you're gonna learn about acoustic guitar gear, discover acoustic artists, and get inspired to live your very best acoustic life. As with all episodes of Acoustic Tuesday, I'm gonna share with you my guitar geek list for the week. But prior to digging into that guitar geek list, I've got an important question for you. Yes, it is your guitar geek trivia question. Now, we just featured five guitars with solid tops, except for one. I should say four guitars with solid tops. And most often, those solid tops are made up of spruce. Now, spruce comes in many different varieties and many different flavors, which brings me to your trivia question. Here it is. Of all the species of spruce, which one grows to be the tallest? Is it A, Engelmann spruce? Is it B, red spruce? Is it C, Sitka spruce? Or is it D, Carpathian spruce? Yes, which one grows to be the tallest? Go ahead and ponder that, and at the end of the show, I'll be sure to give you the answer, along with some incredible footage of a tree that seems to be from yesteryear, from dinosaur times. I don't know, the tree's darn big and you get to see it. So stick around for the answer and to see that footage because it totally wowed me. All right, moving right along here, I'm gonna dig right into our artist of the week. This artist that I'm gonna feature is an American treasure. He's a singer, he's a songwriter, he's a poet, he's a lyricist, he's a producer, he's a luthier. He checks all the Guitar Geek boxes and even more. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking about Guy Clark. Guy Clark is a Guitar Geek that you need to know about. He is a, just bottom line, he's one of my favorite singer-songwriters of all time. Oftentimes I find myself listening to Guy Clark albums, listening intently to the lyrics and thinking, wow, that's simple and so effective. I can't believe he came up with that. And I've got some songs that illustrate that very point. I'm gonna feature those today. Some great footage before we get into the songs. There's some great footage of him in the documentary Heartworn Highways, which I've featured way back early on in Acoustic Tuesday history. If you haven't seen that, go ahead and get it. You can get it on Amazon Prime, rent it, and just enjoy footage of some of the most incredible songwriters, Guy Clark included, very young. We're talking Texas Troubadours, we're talking Rodney Crowell, Townes Van Zandt, Guy Clark, all the usual suspects, Steve Earle, very young Steve Earle. You gotta check it out. You gotta check it out, especially if you have some time on your hands. Again, that's Heartworn Highways. I'll come back on track now and talk about Guy Clark specifically. In fact, one of my favorite tunes that I wanted to feature, and I'm so excited I get to do that. The song is called Dublin Blues off of his Dublin Blues album. Here it is.
I am just a poor boy. Works my middle name. If money was a reason, oh, I would not be the same. But I'll stand up and be counted. I'll face up to the truth. I'll walk away from trouble, but I can't walk away from you. So forgive me all my anger. Forgive me all my faults. There's no need to forgive me for thinking what I thought. And I loved you from the get-go. I love you till I die. And I loved you on the Spanish steps the day you said goodbye.
So many things about that clip that I love. Just specifically talking about Guy Clark, the song itself is one of those songs that creates a mood. I don't care where you are listening to that song, it pulls you away from wherever you are physically and takes you to a place. And I think that is one of the things that Guy Clark is so damn good at. Secondly, his very delicate and almost minimalistic approach to accompanying himself on the guitar. As you can tell by where we left that clip off, he was playing just a nice, delicate, melodic bass solo. And I think that sums up all of his guitar playing. It's just perfect. It fits the song, and I absolutely love listening to him play. And the last thing I'll say about that clip has to do with the reverence the other songwriters are paying him as he's singing that song. At one point in that clip, you can see one of the other songwriters on stage singing along off mic with him. And I think that is just one of the best accolades, the best feelings, the best signs of respect you could ever have as a singer-songwriter, where another high-level, celebrated singer-songwriter actually loves your song to the degree where they're moved to just sing it to themselves while you're sitting there in a songwriters in the round type of scenario. So just a great clip on so many different levels. But let's move to another song that I think, again, shows what Guy Clark is so good at, and that is painting a picture and telling a lesson or conveying a lesson in such a simplistic way and such an effective way. This song is called The Cape. It's also off of the Dublin Blues album, and we're only gonna listen to a piece of it here, but this is one you have to take in its entirety because it's a fantastic story and it has a nice little lesson wrapped up in it. Again, here's the song, The Cape by Guy Clark.
floss, a cape tied all around his neck. He climbed up on the garage, he's figuring what the heck. Screwed his courage up so tight that the whole thing come unwound. He got a running start and bless his heart, he headed for the ground. Well, he's one of those who knows that life is just a leap of faith. Spread your arms and hold your breath and always trust your cape.
Again, you can see in that clip right at the end is his kind of minimalistic, simplistic approach to the guitar that is so effective. In fact, that clip has some great close-ups on his picking hand, and it's just, it's beautiful to watch. Talk about efficient and effective and just plain awesome. And also, you might be wondering, you know, in both of those clips, those guitars look pretty darn cool. Well, Guy actually made those guitars. Guy was a luthier. Guy passed away in May of 2016, and he left quite the legacy, both in luthery, in songwriting, and his songs definitely live on with many, many artists covering them currently. And he has quite the list of albums, which I'm going to get to, but this year, in 2020, they are releasing a documentary called Without Getting Killed or Caught. This is a kind of a interesting story about Guy Clark, Townes Van Sant, some love in there, but also ultimately just Guy's incredibly profound impact on the music industry and his fellow artists. In fact, this particular documentary is narrated by Sissy Spacek, so I feel like this is a convergence of all the worlds that I love. You've got singer-songwriters, you've got Guy Clark, Townes Van Sant, but then you have Sissy Spacek narrating it. Sissy Spacek played Carrie in one of my favorite horror movies of all time, and here she is narrating a great documentary about one of my favorite singer-songwriters of all time. It's like the stars aligned for this one. So without further ado, let's dig into the trailer for Without Getting Killed or Caught, a Guy Clark documentary.
I'm proud to present the ASCAP Lifetime Achievement Award to Guy Clark for his outstanding accomplishments as a songwriter, recording artist, and musical mentor in the field of country music.
Texans really love their heroes, and Guy is a true blue Texas hero.
He was a powerful figure with an enormous presence.
I'm pretty sure they'll say he's one of the greatest American songwriters that ever lived.
Why didn't Guy Clark become a big star? I'm not sure they yet knew how to market a poet of Guy's caliber.
Guy didn't care about pleasing the record label. He was passionate about the songs, and he was hell-bent on doing things his way. It bombed.
And I was lost, looking for something.
I'm Susanna Clark. I live in Nashville with my husband, Guy, and our best friend, Townes Van Zandt.
It was a mythical love story. You had to be there to, to get it.
Guy and I were married. But Townes and I were soulmates.
He knew what was most important to Susanna.
Townes Van Zandt died on January 1st, 1997.
Susanna surrendered something that night. She went to bed and didn't get up.
I love you so much.
I quit and started over. And all I gotta do is do it. Nobody says you can't.
I continued to spiral down as Guy's star kept rising.
Here I am, a folk singer.
He knew what he wanted to be. That's clarity.
Like desperados waiting for dreams.
You know, I'm just cursed with artistic integrity. Lord, what a beautiful woman.
His songs were literature.
It couldn't go on. Waiting for dreams. This might be it.
I never was a country singer. I'm still not a country singer. I just write songs and play them. I'm Guy Clark.
Needless to say, I'm extremely excited to watch that documentary. Now, special note, if you're watching this Acoustic Tuesday show and you didn't just get to see the trailer for Without Getting Killed or Caught, It's because of copyright issues. But if you did get to see it, if they allowed us to keep it in there, well then, bonus day for you and all of us guitar geeks. If you didn't get a chance to see the trailer, make sure to look it up on YouTube or just visit acousticlife.tv. You'll be able to see that trailer in its entirety, and I can guarantee you it's one you want to check out. But let's move right on into some Guy Clark albums that you need to add to your record collection. The very first one, and I should say this because Guy Clark has a ton of albums, I've only picked a few that are my favorite. Released in 1975, Guy Clark's old number one, his very first album, and a phenomenal one at that. Next up, 1976's Texas Cookin'. Then we move on to 1995's Dublin Blues. I have nearly worn out this album. It is truly phenomenal, and it's one of those albums that creates a mood. You put it on, and you just kind of think. You get all introspective. I love this album. I absolutely love this album. Next up, Workbench Songs, released in 2006. You see a nice little picture there. That's the album cover, but that's actually one of Guy Clark's guitars, one of his headstocks on there. Pretty darn cool. And then lastly, his last release, I believe, released in 2013, entitled My Favorite Picture of You. And holy smokes, this is a phenomenal album, and I don't just think that. It actually won a Grammy. And one of the songs on that album is called, I'm getting put on the spot here. I think it's called Hellbent on Heartache. I'm getting chills just talking about it, just saying the name of that song. It's one you have to hear. You just have to hear it. Because the emotion packed up in that song is just, you can't not feel it. You can't not feel it. So that's Guy Clark for you. To learn more about Guy Clark, please visit acousticlife.tv/AT135. You'll get to see those performances in their entirety. There's links to purchase his albums. And of course, that trailer for Without Getting Killed or Caught is there as well. Now I'd like to time travel for just a moment and visit episode 133. That was an episode in which we talked about D18s and D28s. We celebrated those darn guitars, those iconic Martin guitars. And I've got some comments that I pulled from that show that, I just wanted to share with you all. So without further ado, which is about the 70th time I've said without further ado in today's episode, if you're playing that drinking game, I'm sorry. You might not have made it this far. Let's visit our first comment from that episode. It was left by Max McCoy. And he says this, the mystery has been solved. Check this out. Hi, Tony. Thanks for the shout out to Traverse, a journal of the Great Plains and Emporia State University. Sorry for the mystery. Should have included a note. We just thought you'd be interested in our piece on Mossman guitars. Contact us if you'd like some help in doing something on Mossman in the future. We have no connection other than digging the history of the guitars, but we can put you in touch with some folks who knew Stu Mossman. We're on the web, and of course you can see that link there. You can also find us on the usual social media platforms. Cheers. So there was a lot of love for Mossman guitars after I brought up that little magazine that they sent me, that Max sent me. So I should say thank you to Max, but also for those of you who are interested in Mossman guitars, for those of you who are fans of Mossman guitars, make sure to go to episode 133, find Max's comment, and check out that link, because this little magazine, this little publication is just full of juicy guitar geeky stuff, specifically on Mossman guitars. So thanks, Max, and for those guitar geeks that are interested in Mossman guitars, you can certainly continue to do the deep dive. Our next comment comes from Palmer Grigsby, and he says this, all caps, so I'm assuming he's yelling, Tony, you didn't catch Sturgill back in the day? You missed out for sure. My friends and I were fortunate enough to catch him at a music festival called Forecastle in Kentucky several years ago before he really took off. Beautiful 80-degree day, Sturgill played in front of 35 people. It was like having an awesome concert at a family reunion. Next up was another artist before they took off, Chris Stapleton, who played for maybe 25 people. Mind you, both of these individuals are currently, well, probably postponed, but they are selling out arenas. So this is a magical moment here for Palmer. And he says, I'm really glad I got to see them both before they shot off into the atmosphere. I would venture to say stratosphere, quite possibly beyond. I don't know the next sphere, but it's probably well beyond the atmosphere, the stratosphere, and the exosphere. I don't know if that's one, but it sounds like it could be cool. Probably a Google-o-sphere somewhere out there. Anyways, Palmer says, love the show. It's time I grab some merch. Well, I agree. I'm more on that here in just a moment. But let's move to our next comment from Joshua Henderson. Excuse me. This has been my favorite AT episode. I am also blessed to own both a D18 and D28. My dad bought me a 28 as a college graduation present in 2014, and I just recently bought an 18. A 2019 Martin D18 a month ago. They're both awesome. The older 28 has lots of bass and warmth, but the reimagined 18s are just as powerful. And then for all you guitar geeks wondering, he just said, his recommendation, he said, just buy both. Just get both the Martin D18 and the D28. I concur, Joshua. Thanks for leaving your endorsement of both. Next comment comes from Jim Doner. First, he says, what's the mailing address for Acoustic Tuesday? Well, I'm glad you asked, Jim. It's 2335 Birdie Drive, like the golf term, B-I-R-D-I-E. And that's in Bozeman, Montana, zip code 59715. If anybody wants to send anything to the mailbag, we will certainly accept that with gracious guitar geek arms. Jim also says this when I asked for other recommendations on D18s and D28s. He says, the 1970s Takamine higher-end made in Japan dreads sounded great. These are also known as the lawsuit dreads, if my memory serves me correctly, and they look damn near identical to a Martin D28 and a Martin D18, but even to down to the font they used on the headstock, but they do sound darn good, especially the made in Japan ones. So thanks, Jim, for leaving your comment. Next up, we have a comment from, I'm going to try and pronounce this correctly, Andrelix. Hey, Tony, just watched this episode on Martins and had to give a shout out for the Molly Tuttle clip. I agree. Having Molly Tuttle in the show is pretty much a necessity. I was mesmerized by the tune called Keeping the Cats Happy and Molly's fluid style when I fell on the clip a few months ago. Been trying to work out a fingerstyle version ever since. May never happen, but watching and listening to the clip over and over again is no hardship. Cheers, Andro. P.S. I would love to own a Martin D28, preferably vintage. May never happen either. That's okay. It's good to get those wishes, those guitar geek wishes out there because you never know what can happen. You could have one come down through the family. You could have a neighbor say, hey, you know, I can't play the guitar anymore. I'm thinking of giving it up. And you could caretake a guitar for them and it could be a vintage Martin D28. You never know. The guitar geek world operates in crazy, crazy, crazy ways. And it's a small world after all. For those of you who I got that song stuck in your head, I apologize greatly. Bottom line, I just want to thank everybody for their comments back on episode 133 and, of course, all previous episodes of Acoustic Tuesday. As I mentioned before, you guitar geeks in this community, you all are top-notch. I appreciate you so much, and I love that we can have these discussions via the comments, and I love that you participate and interact in the show and with your fellow guitar geeks in the comments as well. In fact, there was another awesome comment that I just saw before we sat down for filming, and it said, it's quite simply, I forgot who left the comment, it quite simply was a statement. It said, you weren't born with tattoos or a hockey jersey. Now, I'm not sure what to do with that statement. But I think I can probably dig up a baby picture where I think I was born with tattoos and a hockey jersey, contrary to popular belief. Pretty sure that's how I came out. Yep, old Steve and Sue were surprised when I came out. They were like, Andy's born. There he is, all tatted up with a hockey jersey on. I can't believe this is our son. But hopefully they're proud of me. Moving on, there's another couple of comments I want to feature. Gary Schultz says this, but Tone, can you drive a Zamboni? And to that I said, no, Gary, I can't drive a Zamboni, but I do play goalie, just like Scott Ayers, the emergency backup goalie for the Carolina Hurricanes. This picture was taken by one of my teammates, Dan Lakatos, and it makes me look a lot better than I am, which is exactly why I wanted to feature it, because just judging by this picture alone, I mean, my pads kind of match, I got the stance down. You know, I look pretty good, so we'll just leave it at that. I won't comment on my statistics or anything. Another comment from Steven S. He just says this, and I wanted to just say this real quick. He says, I showed up to the video when it had 28 likes. Must be a sign. That was the D28 episode, so I thought that was pretty cool as well. And again, just bottom line, thanks so much for all your comments. We even had a geography lesson from Davy Joe Weaver. And he said, yes, there's a couple of Pennsylvania geography terms we should know about. There are two towns, one called Bird in Hand, that's a real town name, and just after Bird in Hand on the interstate is a town called Intercourse. Yep, I'm speechless. But if you live in Intercourse, it's gotta be fun writing that on your return address, you know, when you pay your bills. I don't know. Just a random thought. I'll leave it at that. Let's move right along, shall we? Please do know that you can support the Acoustic Tuesday show by visiting acoustictuesday.store. Pick up your favorite t-shirt, hooded sweatshirt, and please put it on and share a picture with us. How do you do that? It's super easy. Go to the store. Once you receive your designated Acoustic Tuesday merchandise, please put it on and take a picture. You could be out to dinner. You could be at a show. You could be just hanging out in your living room playing guitar. We want to see you supporting the Acoustic Tuesday show. And lastly, please submit it at acousticlife.tv. There's a submit link in the top menu, and you can go ahead and submit your picture just like Don P. did. Don P. is located in Syracuse. However you say it, it's in New York. And he says, hello, Tony P. and company. At a restaurant just outside of Syracuse, New York, I did it again, the wife and I were having snacks before heading to an acoustic Citizen Cope show. Not long into our stay, the place started buzzing. I turned around to see Mr. Clarence Greenwood himself walk into the room. He was meeting with some people, and I managed to get a picture with him. That set the tone for an amazing evening. What a great guy and an awesome show. He'll be at the Emerson Center in Bozeman on May 20th, 2020. Get there. So cool. I love those stories. To be wearing a shirt like that, you know, celebrating your guitar geekiness and then going to a show and then all of a sudden running into one of your heroes. That's pretty darn awesome. I had a similar experience here in town. The family and I went out to see Coulter Wall. We're sitting at this burger joint. And lo and behold, one table over is Coulter Wall and his entire band. And I just clammed up because I love Coulter Wall. I love his music. I love his songwriting. And I didn't say a darn word. I just sat very uncomfortably, half listening to the family's conversation, half listening to the band's conversation, not being present anywhere. It was a pretty neat moment. Anyways, let's visit the mailbag, shall we? I got some interesting arrivals this week. One that, you'll find them slightly out of the ordinary. Speaking of being a goalie, I got a new goalie stick. It's a Sherwood M90. It's really cool. I think it makes me stop pucks more. I know that's not guitar related, but I do have a guitar related arrival in my digital mailbox. My folks just recently went to see Charlie Parr in Appleton, Wisconsin, and they sent this picture and I was absolutely delighted. Charlie Parr is a dear friend of mine, and I just want to publicly thank Charlie for taking the time to talk to my folks and put on a great show. There's my dad and mom. My dad's there supporting the Acoustic Tuesday for Vets initiative, which is so cool. And thanks to my folks for sending that. And of course, thanks to Charlie for, again, taking that time. Another couple interesting digital mailbox arrivals. You know, if this is a combination physical and digital, that's getting weird. A couple weeks ago, Fender sent me an Acoustasonic Stratocaster. And I've been playing with it. And at first I was like, I don't know about this. But I'm starting to really get into it. I'm starting to really enjoy playing it. There's a review coming up on Acoustic Tuesday, a future episode, don't worry. I won't fully keep it in the dark. But I'll tell you, something recently just clicked for me, and it sealed the deal at how cool the Acoustasonic Stratocaster is. And it's the fact that Molly Tuttle was just at the studios in Fender, and she actually performed with the Acoustasonic Stratocaster. And it was a delight to watch, and I just thought I'd share it with you all. So here it is. Sitting at home playing the Acoustasonic Stratocaster thinking, man, this is really cool. And then it clicked. And I saw that. I saw Molly Tuttle playing the Acoustasonic Stratocaster and bam, I immediately felt part of the Cool Kids Club. So Thanks, Molly, for making me feel cool. I really appreciate that. Next up in the digital mailbox arrivals sequence here, which sounded really robotic. I don't know why I said it like that. Anyways, the folks at Emerald Guitars make some of the best carbon fiber instruments, period. Their custom shop is incredible. They have all these cool models. The Amicus is one of my favorites. The X20 is one of my favorites. They've got the X7, the X10, the X30. They've got harp guitars, you name it. Holy smokes, they got basses, nylon strings. The options are endless. I absolutely love the folks at Emerald Guitars. And each week, they make a shipping video of the guitars that they're shipping out to their customers. And I happened to stumble upon one, and there was an interesting shout out from Chloe, who hosts the shipping video. So I wanna thank Chloe for mentioning Tony's Acoustic Challenge and also mentioning one of the jam clubs within Tony's Acoustic Challenge. And without further ado, why don't you just go ahead and take it away, Chloe.
Next exam we've got going is going to Robert in Maryland. Robert's going for the level 2 system. Now, I was talking to Robert on live chat about this guitar. He told me he was part of Tony's Acoustic Challenge in the East. So he's in that. This must be the 6th or 7th Emerald going there, if I'm right. But the first X10, there's Dominic and Sharon and the likes of Chuck as well. They all have our guitars. Apparently Sharon makes the best breakfast. So I want Sharon to come over here and make us breakfast someday. Big trip out for you all in the East. Next up, we have...
I mean, how cool is that? Here I am watching this shipping video, and it's like, oh, this is going to Robert from Tony's Acoustic Challenge. He's part of TAC East, and you got Dom, Sharon, Chuck. And I just was kind of, I found myself smiling hugely. words do not express how awesome, and the sentiment there is true. Sharon makes incredible food, not just breakfast. In fact, fried meatballs come to mind. I don't need to explain, but they're really, really good. So thank you, Sharon, Dom, Robert, Chuck, everybody in TAC East. Thank you, Emerald Guitars. Chloe, I love the way you host the shipping videos. If you ever find yourself, you know, in the U.S., I mean, you could co-host the Acoustic Tuesday show with me. I think that'd be pretty darn cool. I'm just going to throw that out there. If you want to make a video response to that, I would totally accept it. Anyways, moving right along, one more final digital mailbox arrival, and this is so cool because back on episode 109, we featured a fingerstyle maestro, Manelli Jamal. I mean, talk about incredible compositions and just a great guitar player with great sense of composition. If you missed that episode, don't worry, I'm gonna catch you up real quick. Here is his song, Breaking Dawn. Misnamed the song there. It's called Break of Dawn. But nonetheless, you're thinking to yourself, Tone, okay, what about this digital mailbox arrival? You just mentioned an artist, but you didn't say what arrived. Well, Manelli took time out of his schedule to answer 3 of our Acoustic Life questions, and I am darn right just tickled pink about it. So without further ado, that's about the 10th time I've said that. Here is Manelli Jamal answering 3 Acoustic Life questions.
Hey there, I'm Manelli Jamal, and I'm here to answer 3 Acoustic Life questions with you here today. So question number 1, who is an artist that is under the radar that deserves a little bit more attention? Now, I don't really listen to too much music these days. I find that the vacancy of music in my life allows me to be a little bit more creative in my flow anyway. But if I had to say someone, it would be Alexander Mishko from Russia, an amazingly talented acoustic guitar player who does pretty much everything on the acoustic guitar. Really talented, really nice guy too. So I definitely say check him out. Question number 2, out of all the guitars that I own, which is my favorite and why? Lately, I've just been playing my own signature model guitar, which is right here, the Cole Clark Manelli Jamal signature model. It's got a nice pickup system there as well. And the reason I love this guitar is simply because the pickup system is just so accurate with trying to get an acoustic sound out of the guitar when I'm playing live. It's pretty much a plug and play, and that's what I want. I don't really want to have to deal too much with, electronics too much and sound check. It's just, I like to just get in there, do a quick sound check, and know it's going to sound great. And I know that this guitar is always going to deliver that sonic sound that I'm looking for. So question number three is, what is one piece of gear that has changed my acoustic life? And I would definitely say this guy right here. This is an Ebo. It basically creates an electromagnetic field around the string, vibrating it. And it creates this sort of like violin sound or synth sound with no attack. And I use this in a few of my pieces, and this in combination with my Strymon pedals, where I'm like freezing certain notes, allows me to have just like a huge kind of ambient sound and feel that I've just been exploring a lot more these days. I mean, other than that, I would say, of course, the capo, which I have here just as G7 capo. I do a lot of partial capo stuff too. So the combination of those, I think, really allowed me to have a lot of freedom as an acoustic guitar player. Thanks so much for having me here, Tony. Guitar geeks unite.
Much appreciation to Minnelli for sharing that with us, letting us in on his acoustic life and some of the things that have changed it for the better. So very cool to get those reports from the artists that we've featured. In fact, I always feel like, gosh, it just feels darn cool when those come in. I'm just so delighted. So again, thanks, Minnelli. I appreciate you taking the time out to answer our questions. Now, we're about ready to wrap up the show. I do have your Guitar Geek trivia question coming up, the answer to that. But first, I just want to take a moment, and I just want to, again, express a ton of gratitude for you. You, Guitar Geek, watching the show right now. You are exactly what makes this show be week in and week out. If it wasn't for you watching the show wouldn't exist. If it wasn't for you leaving comments, this show wouldn't exist. If it wasn't for you just being a guitar geek and being enthusiastic about guitar, this show wouldn't exist. So I owe a great debt of gratitude to you, guitar geek, that watch the show. I am always humbled by the amount of views that we get, the amount of comments that we get. And bottom line, I mentioned this before at the top of the show, but I'll mention it again because it kind of leads into a story that I want to share with you all. And that is, I am so thankful for this Guitar Geek community, because in a time when we might not be able to get out of the house and physically connect with other people and have conversations or go to a jam, we can actually connect every single Tuesday on the Acoustic Tuesday show. We can wave our Guitar Geek flag, we can be guitar geeks, we can escape a little bit and sink into a hobby that we love, a hobby that's a source of positivity, a hobby that's a source of fun and progress, a hobby that makes us feel really good about ourselves, and that is playing guitar. One of the things that I've learned in my guitar journey that started when I was 18 years old is that, you know, the guitar is always there. It's always there to lean on. It's always a source of positivity. It's always a source of escape in a good way, not a head in the sand type of way, but just something positive that's always there to lean on. And that's one of the things I want to drive home right now. During times when you're nervous, anxious, worried, angry, sad, you name it, all the emotions can range from good to bad to indifferent, the guitar is always there for you. And it was there for me when I first picked it up when I was 18. In fact, I talk about hockey a lot on the show, and I'm just going to take a second and get a little vulnerable with you all. It's a story I don't normally share, but I figured, what the hell, why not? We're all guitar geeks, right? When I was 18, I was playing junior hockey up until I was 18 years old. And then at that point in time, there was kind of this decision of like, do you continue playing hockey or do you go get a job? Do you go to college? What do you do? And I was just frankly burnt out. There was a sport that I absolutely loved and sunk all my time and effort into, but I was totally burnt out. I didn't want anything to do with hockey anymore. And at that point in time, my dad took the guitar out of the crawl space. Randomly, I was just getting into music and things like that, and I started to learn a couple of things on the guitar. And it just, this little spark, it was tiny at that point in time, this little spark kind of lit up and ignited a passion for me. But that's not the end of the story. During that first year when I was not playing hockey and I was adjusting to trying to go to school and not really knowing what I wanted to do, I fell into some really bad habits. I fell into some kind of a lot of self-sabotage moments. some really unhealthy things. I don't have to go into too many details, but nonetheless, I always found myself leaning on the guitar, whether it was a bad night, emotionally bad day, things weren't going my way. And I just want to say this, let the guitar be that source of positivity for you. Let this Guitar Geek community support you on your unique guitar journey and know that you can turn to that guitar at any point in time for a little ray of sunshine, for a little piece of motivation, for a little inspiration, for a creative outlet. You know, it's one of the things we can actually control is to turn to the guitar, play a song, put a smile on your face. And you know, if you were slated to play your first open mic and you didn't get a chance to do that, post a video on YouTube. Say, hey everybody, this is my first time playing publicly and I wanted to do this and I'm gonna do it. Nothing's gonna stop me. Or if you were scheduled to go to a jam and you feel like, man, I guess I can't do that anymore. You know, it takes a lot of courage to get to that point to feel like I'm gonna do this. And then when things outside of our control change that, it's like, shoot, what do I do? Well, try and connect with another guitar geek. You've got plenty here that watch the Acoustic Tuesday show. Maybe you can connect and collaborate via email. Come up with a song and post it to SoundCloud. Still share your music. Don't let things out of our control get in our way, especially when we can actually control picking up the guitar and creating and making fun memories and making people come together. That's one of the things that the guitar has proven to be day in and day out is it's always there. It's always there as an outlet, whether you're, again, as I said, angry, sad, disgusted, confused, it's always there. And it's really, I'll say this, the guitar has become my best friend. And I'm sure as a guitar geek watching the show, it's likely become your best friend as well. So let's lean on our friends, both real people and inanimate objects that somehow are always there for us. So during times of distress, just please lean on your guitar and connect. We're in an age where we really have the ability to connect with so many people without having to leave our house. And I want to encourage you to explore those options because there's some really good ones out there and there's some great guitar geeks out there that are just waiting to connect with you, connect with me, and connect with other guitar geeks and just want to have fun and progress and be, well, guitar geeks together. So again, just lean on that guitar when times get tough. I know I was a little bit long-winded, but I just wanted to share that with you all because it's something I sometimes think I take for granted. But when stuff starts to zoom into focus and when the real priorities actually rise to the top, I think to myself, man, I'm really grateful. The guitar is a hobby of mine and I have this outlet and encourage others to pursue that as well. So that's my little inspirational corner for you. I want to, again, thank you for your time in watching the Acoustic Tuesday show today with me and your other fellow guitar geeks. What an amazing community we've all created together. I'm so proud of each and every one of you for being a part of this community. I want to wrap up the show, but before I do that, let's dig into your Guitar Geek trivia question. Let's wrap up and put an end to this debate on what's the tallest spruce variety. What's the deal? If you need a reminder of your question, it is this. Of all the species of spruce in the entire world, which one of them grows to be the tallest? Is it A, Engelmann spruce, B, red spruce, C, Sitka spruce, or D, Carpathian spruce? Well, if you found yourself answering C, Sitka spruce, you're absolutely correct. Sitka spruce can grow to be almost 100 meters or 330 feet tall with a trunk diameter that can exceed 5 meters or 16 feet. It is by far the largest species of spruce in the world. Here's a couple of fun facts while you see this individual climbing up on what is, I think, the tallest spruce tree in the world. He's climbing up on the roots there for a sense of scale. That's an enormous tree. Here's some other fun facts. It's also the fifth largest conifer in the world, behind giant sequoia, coast redwood, kauri, and western red cedar, and the third tallest conifer species, after coast redwood and coast Douglas fir. Sitka spruce is one of the few species documented to exceed 300 feet in height. Its name is derived from the community of Sitka in southeast Alaska, where it is prevalent. Its range hugs the western coast of Canada and the U.S., continuing south into northernmost California. Pretty fantastic set of facts there, especially when you think about all the guitars that utilize spruce as a top wood. And to know a little bit more about it, seeing it in this raw form is kind of another degree of connection with the guitar. So with that being said, let's take a quick sneak peek into next week to see what's going to happen. And all I have written in my notes is Tony Tone, fantastic 80s group. I believe it was a boy band made up of all Tonys. Does it get any better than that? No, we're not going to talk about them. We're going to talk about Tony Rice. We're going to stay on the Tony theme. We're going to play a little bit of a game next week. It's not going to be the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, but it will be the 6 degrees of Tony Rice, and I want you to be there for that game because, well, it's going to be fun, and I don't even know how it's going to go yet. So please be there to support me to see how it's going to go. But it's going to be fun nonetheless, and of course, we'll be waving our Guitar Geek flag as we do every single time on Acoustic Tuesday. Remember, you can catch Acoustic Tuesday every single Tuesday at 10 a.m. Mountain Time here on YouTube. And for your Acoustic Tuesday fix in between Tuesdays, just visit acousticlife.tv, where you can do a deep dive on anything I've ever featured on Acoustic Tuesday. Thank you so much for sharing your time with me today. Thank you so much for being a guitar geek. Thank you so much for creating the Acoustic Tuesday show along with me. I appreciate it so much. I appreciate you. Remember to lean on that guitar as much as you possibly can, especially with some time free. Just go ahead and play guitar. What better way to occupy your time and, well, have fun and connect. Well, until next week on Acoustic Tuesday, well, I'll see you then. And remember, Guitar Geeks Unite. Cheers. Take care.